Have you ever heard a recording of your voice? Didn't it sound different than you expected? You know why? When we talk, we're hearing sound waves transmitted through the bones in our head and through the air into our ear canal, two different mediums. The mechanical properties of your head amplify deeper, lower frequency vibrations. When I hear my voice in a recording, I'm only hearing the waves that were transmitted through the air, with none of the waves that I would normally be hearing transmitted through my head. Do I really sound like that? Okay, here's something else about waves. Another sound phenomenon we experience every day is called diffraction. It's the bending of waves around a barrier. Let me show you. Cornelius, can you hear me?
Yes, I sure can.
So even when I'm in another room, Cornelius can hear me because sound waves bend around objects or diffract. Just like waves in water bend around a boat, sound waves are doing the same thing. They're making a great escape. Some sound waves will hit the entryway and get absorbed, but others make it through the entryway and transfer the energy to particles on the other side. That's diffraction. The reason Cornelius hears me is because the sound waves of my voice are bending around the edges of the entryway and walls. How well sound waves do this depends on their wavelength. Longer wavelength, lower frequency waves diffract more as they travel through and around an entryway. Because they bend so much, it's more difficult to figure out where they're coming from. They are less directional. Shorter wavelength, higher frequency waves, on the other hand, don't bend as much, so they are more directional. Think about when you hear thunder. The thunder from a bolt of lightning that strikes close to you will sound like a sharp crack, indicating the presence of shorter wavelength, high frequency sound. The thunder from a distant lightning strike will sound like a low rumble, since the long wavelengths will be the ones that bend around the objects to get to you. The high frequency parts of the sound can't bend around barriers, so they get absorbed by the surroundings before they hit your ear. The ability to hear low and high frequencies depends on who does the hearing. The audible range of hearing for humans is about 20 to 20,000 hertz, or 20 kilohertz. Anything lower than 20 hertz is known as infrasonic, and anything above 20,000 hertz is ultrasonic. Different animals hear and produce different frequencies. Elephants, for example, can be miles apart and still communicate with each other using frequencies that are infrasonic to humans, the sound waves with frequencies lower than 20 hertz. These wavelengths are so long, and they can bend around objects like trees so well, that elephants can hear them up to 6 miles away. Bats are very different. They don't need their sounds to diffract and bend around objects like the longer wavelengths do. They need to pinpoint objects precisely, so they can target prey like bugs and navigate obstacles in their path. They emit short wavelengths that reflect off objects close by and back to the bat. These pulses of high-frequency sound can be as high as 50 kilohertz, more than 2.5 times higher than the highest sound humans can hear. These frequencies are ultrasonic to humans, but not to bats. They hear these sounds. So when I yell, "Hey, you!" the sound leaving my mouth sends energy that compresses air molecules together in some places and leaves gaps in others. The compressed areas are high pressure, called compressions. The areas of lower pressure are called rarefactions. Okay, back to sound tracking. That's what they call it when they record my voice. So think of sound waves as waves of energy, and sometimes we have the ability to manipulate them. I'm in a special sound room that does just that. The sound waves from my voice can't leave the room because they're absorbed by the padding. That's very different than if I was in the studio hallway, where sound waves bounce off walls at all different angles. The reflection of many sound waves, compounded one upon another within a space, is called reverberation. Okay, here's another characteristic of sound waves called sound interference. Interference happens when two waves occupy the same space at the same time. Constructive interference occurs when both waves are identical in frequency and their compressions and rarefactions are aligned 100%. When this happens, we say they're in phase with each other. Basically, they add to each other. So what do you think happens to the sound? Does it get louder or softer? If the two sound waves undergo constructive interference, their amplitude increases and the sound gets louder. There's another way two waves can interfere with each other. That's when they're 180 degrees out of phase with each other. That's called destructive interference. So what happens to the sound if the waves undergo destructive interference? The sound waves cancel each other out, and the result is no sound. The fact that waves line up like this is called the principle of superposition. The principle of superposition tells us when waves in space interfere with one another, they combine to form bigger or smaller waves. But even when this happens, each wave maintains its individuality. Ultimately, they pass through each other unchanged. The net displacement of the medium, that is, all the compressions and rarefactions at any point, is simply the sum of the individual waves. In fact, all waves from sound to light follow this same principle, as you'll see in another segment. So constructive and destructive seem like they're opposites, right? But sometimes you can get both. Let's say you have a loud sound source in a room with two slightly open windows that are close together. Maybe someone is playing their favorite song full volume. If you're in the room, you're overwhelmed. And if you're standing outside the open windows, it can seem pretty loud too. Why is so much sound coming through those two narrow windows? This is an example of double slit diffraction. Sound is traveling through two openings like windows, rather than a single opening like a door. And the window doesn't have to be wide open. This even works with two small slits. When sound travels through two separate openings, some of the waves leaving one window will match up to the waves leaving the other window. You have compressions on compressions and rarefactions on rarefactions. That's called constructive interference. The black spaces on the right show where the waves don't match up. That means the compressions of the waves from one window line up with the rarefactions of the waves from the other window, and they cancel each other out. That's destructive interference. If I were standing in the destructive interference zone, the music will be much more quiet. If I were standing in a constructive interference zone, the music will sound loud. When sound waves with almost identical frequencies interfere with one another, you get a rhythmic change in amplitude, loud to soft, which we hear as beats. The beat frequency is the absolute value of the difference between the high and the low frequency. So if we play a tone at 450 hertz and one at 452 hertz, the beat frequency will be 2 hertz. 450 hertz. 452 hertz. Do you hear it? We're just scratching the surface of how we can manipulate sound. Everything from creating echoes to combining sound waves in a way that they actually disappear. You'll certainly appreciate sound effects in movies more, knowing the physics of sound. And if you ever thought about being a sound engineer, or even an architect, getting this physics down will help you design better sound environments and technologies, like speaker systems, where it's important that sound waves ring clear and don't appear to disappear. That's it for this segment of Physics in Motion. We'll see you guys next time. What you got, Cornelius?
For more practice problems, lab activities, and note-taking guides, check out the Physics in Motion Toolkit.